Capture the Flag hacking competitions are awesome to learn hacking and to teach the most valuable skills needed for various IT security jobs. My introduction to IT security was a Stripe CTF and then war games such as IO Smash the Stack or W3 Charles. They are not the best resource to learn security nowadays. I would point at Pico CTF and Over the Wire, but they were fun. There's a reason why modern schools move away from teacher-centered teaching. It seems efficient, but it doesn't engage students. To become an expert in IT security, you just need to accumulate thousands of hours doing IT. And the competitive and playful environments by CTFs provide the motivation and energy to spend countless of hours on various technologies. And maybe some beginner challenges like a buffer overflow from 1995 seems out of date and useless, but in the process you learn much more. You learn how to use GDB, you understand memory and assembly, you start to learn C and system programming, you learn about other debugging tools such as ltrace and strace, about processes and the proc file system, and about Linux permissions like setuid. And this is huge! The amount of knowledge you acquire just along the way is crazy. It's the old saying, the path is more important than the goal. The alternative would be that I have to read up on those tools directly, maybe read a book, but that is effing boring. Why not just learn all of this while playing a game? So let's explore why CTFs are awesome. Let's look at a bit more up-to-date examples. Check out, for example, the challenge uploooadit from the DEFCON qualifiers. It was a web challenge that many teams solved. Here, for example, the write-up by Bullstock. When you read the source code and poke around at the application, you find out that some errors are coming from GUnicorn and other errors come from HAProxy, which gives you some information about the overall system architecture. And the challenge turned out to be an HTTP request smuggling or HTTP desync attack against this combination of HAProxy and GUnicorn. If you do casual Google search, you might even find a write-up by Nathan Davison describing one technique for HAProxy which you can try to apply here. But a challenge like this, which forces players to do research, might even lead to the discovery of unintended solution because many players do not just read blog posts by other people, but dig into the source code of the software used and find new vulnerabilities, ultimately pushing their own knowledge and their field forward. It's worth mentioning that I also tried to use the Burp plugin that automatically scans for this issue, but it didn't find it, at least with the default configuration. So this challenge is great to learn about and execute your own HTTP desync attack. And it teaches you not to rely on tools, but to do it yourself. So this was pretty introductory. It's a challenge where as a beginner, you can learn something new, or where I, somebody who works in security, can reflect on myself and ask, would I have found this? If this was a setup by a client asking for a pen test? Ask yourself, would you be able to find it? Next, let's look at something more advanced. For example, this magic tunnel challenge. It was a website, a photo album where you could enter an image as a URL and then the website would download it and show it to you. That's a very typical web application feature. For example, on Imgur, when you want to add a new image, you can also enter a URL to download it from. So let's check out Carolina's write-up from this challenge. First, she noted that there is a local file inclusion vulnerability. If instead of providing a URI with HTTP, but you enter a URI that starts with file, the web application will read a local file to you, like etc passwd. Cool, this already is a typical web security vulnerability worth reporting. But the goal for this challenge was to escalate further, and you could use this vulnerability to examine the server. So Carolina writes, you could read from procself cmd line to see the command line of the server process, which turns out to be a UWSGI server, and it was listening on local port 8000. When you send your HTTP request to Nginx, it communicates internally with the web app using UWSGI on port 8000. You could also figure out that the web application was a Django app, the Python web framework Django, which has a typical folder structure, and thus you can now leak most of the source code. And in there, you could also find the reason for the local file inclusion, which stems from using pycurl. And now the challenge gets actually crazy. Nginx talks to UWSGI via a special protocol, and it supports a few features such as the load the specific file as a new dynamic app. The attack idea is now to use the request sent by PyCurl and target its own local port 8000, performing a SSRF, server-side request forgery, and make UWSGI execute an arbitrary script. Problem is that this is a special protocol and you can't easily send those packets. But then she abuses a trick where she uses the Gopher protocol to smuggle it in. To summarize, by making the web app download this image URL, it will use Gopher to talk to the local port 8000, and this portion is a smuggled UWSGI packet, making UWSGI execute a script like tmp test.py. Because this website downloads images, you could now know the location of those downloaded files and you can place a reverse shell there and execute it. You get remote code execution and you can read the flag. The exploit is totally realistic. Anybody who says it's not is stupid. It might be rare, sure, but that doesn't matter. It can happen, and if a client pays you to find shit, they expect that you are able to do so. And keep in mind, in a real app, there is so much more functionality, which might make it even harder to identify. So this challenge is easier than it would have been in the real world. Which means, if you cannot solve this as a CTF challenge, you are unfit to do real world work. I don't actually mean that, because people miss stuff all the time. Everybody has a different skill set and everybody constantly has to learn, but it's a good mental exercise. And CTFs constantly remind me to not be a lazy ass and sit on OWASP top 10 checklist. Always dig deeper. I think that is expected of me in my job. Let's have a look at a similar challenge, but this time in an actual real application, the flaglab challenge. This was just plain GitLab. It was a real world application which had a similar security issue, and I made a whole video about that. But there you also had a server-side request forgery, and to exploit it, you had to use the Git protocol to smuggle a Redis command to the Redis server. Similar to how in the Magic Tunnel challenge, you used Gopher to smuggle UWSGI packets. You see, those are the same principles and ideas, just executed on different technologies. I bet that 99% of all web developers who ever used Nginx with UWSGI or Redis have no clue what exactly they are using, and more importantly, the risks the setup has if there is an SSRF. There's an argument to be had that they don't have to know, it's not their job, true, but for myself, I don't care what the average is. I want to be better. I want to be the web developer who knows this. But those two examples should also show you that the goal is not necessarily to know all the different things, but to learn about those fundamental principles and practice them so that you can identify and execute them in the real world on real targets with all kinds of technologies. When we look into Carolina's conclusion for Magic Tunnel, we learn that she and her team didn't actually solve this challenge. But thanks to other write-ups, she was able to work through the solution afterwards and learn about how UWSGI works. And this is where we get into the next important part of CTF, the write-ups. The fact that they weren't able to solve it during the CTF is irrelevant. Playing the CTF is just mostly for fun, but having worked through the challenge afterwards, Carolina now knows a bit more and is now a bit more skilled than other people. I say this all the time. It's normal not to solve challenges. It doesn't matter. Reading write-ups and working through solutions is as much part of CTF as playing the challenges themselves. I would even argue that reading the write-ups is more important for learning than playing the CTF itself. Solving a challenge often means you already had the ability and skills to do it. But not solving a challenge, or just barely solving it after 12 hours of work, then you learn something new. If you find yourself solving a challenge every hour, you do it wrong. You are just getting dopamine kicks, which is fun too, of course, I do the same, but you are not learning anything. Good CTF challenges teach you about issues and techniques that are usable when doing real-world work. They teach you about vulnerability classes you should know about, but also teach you about various technologies which can be useful to find other vulnerabilities in the future. instilling a research mindset into the player. Knowledge transfer can happen in very different ways. In our industry, we see many experts giving talks at conferences, but I fall asleep at any conference talk, no matter how interesting the topic. I'm not kidding. If I fall asleep in your talk or class, it's not you. I just can't stay awake. So for me, that's not a good medium. And like there are good and bad talks, making a good CTF challenge is not easy. To have great knowledge transfer through a challenge, it requires a lot of thought and work by the author. But if they are done right, for me, CTFs are the best way to learn something new. And when I say CTFs, I mean the whole package, including, or maybe mostly, CTF write-ups. Write-ups. This also means bug bounty write-ups can be a great source. And in fact, the GitLab challenge I mentioned earlier heavily references a bug bounty write-up. But bug bounty write-ups are rarely reproducible because the platforms got fixed. The GitLab write-up is obviously an exception. But generally, they are not super ideal for learning, and that's where CTFs, where the challenges often get released, are so much better. Good CTF challenges, like Magic Tunnel, are made up, but implement a realistic vulnerability to teach you about a specific thing. And that's the point. It might be made up, and maybe nobody will ever implement it like that in reality, and you will never see this in your career again. But the importance is that they could exist. And me wanting to be a professional, I want to be able to find it. We all know, finding all vulnerabilities in a product is unrealistic. But that doesn't mean you just find the low-hanging fruits and call a job done. No, I want to strive towards 100% and go for the bugs that might be a bit obscure, but could totally exist. Why the F in the world would anybody hire some shitty consultant who admits they only can do OWASP top 10, because that's 95% of all vulnerabilities? That's such a bullshit management calculation. 95% is very close to 100%. Even if you won't find 100%, and that's reality, wouldn't you at least want to be theoretically have the skill to find them, striving towards that goal? We accept that we won't ever reach it, but being deliberately ignorant about this, staying still and never wanting to learn more, makes me furious. So CTFs help me to always improve, always learn more, always get more experience to find the interesting bugs that most people would miss. And from my work experience, I can tell I found the craziest issues in clients' code that really look like a CTF challenge. Not often, but that's not the point. When they are there, I want to be able to find them. I think any professional who says CTFs are unrealistic has never actually reported crazy vulnerabilities to their clients or played only shitty CTFs. The CTF guidelines document summarizes CTFs as: CTF competitions are about creative infosec problem solving in a competitive environment, competing in creativity, problem solving, skills, and speed in a wide range of areas related to security. For me, speed is not important at all, but creativity and problem solving are where CTFs excel. And I would add to the list the community aspect. I started out playing alone, but after a few years, I found a team. And solving challenges together and celebrating the CTF afterwards and explaining solutions to each other is amazing. But beyond your team, something every solo player can participate in too is the sharing and exchanging of write-ups. The time in IRC, or nowadays Discord, after the CTF is special. It kinda has the old school hacking vibes where research was exchanged in zines. I hope I was able to convince you why CTFs are awesome. Of course, I'm very biased, but I try to look at both sides. So check out the other video, CTFs are terrible.